Coming up on this episode of the Roundtable.
I don't want to defund the police. Come on, man.
It's Donald Trump. Yeah, exactly. Right. Trump. You know the thing. It's Trump. That's the kind of memory holding we're talking about. They stand there and they tell you, we're going to remove your protection. We're going to burn your cities down. We're going to destroy you unless you put us in power. But it's Trump who's your enemy.
And we've seen it in all these things. The first thing you do is confess your white privilege mm-hmm. or whatever. And then at the bottom of her little whiteboard, it says, you know, here you can give me money at PayPal.
Yeah, pay me for this.
You can pay your indulgence here. Confess your sin, Whitey, and you can pay your indulgence here.
Yep.
And, you know, you got to be wiped clean. You can leave this room absolved of at least temporarily until the next installment of the struggle session and the paying. Welcome, everyone, once again to the Roundtable, the American Minds Editors and Publishers podcast. Well, for a while, it's been just the Editors podcast. I'm your host, Ryan Williams, publisher of the American Mind, the Claremont Review Books, and president of the Claremont Institute. Happily back in the host's chair after some able hosting by Spencer Clavin, among others. He relinquished the chair without too much of a fight. He's nursing his wounds. No. This is an amicable place to work. And we're grateful to you, Spencer, for filling in while we were fellowshipping, et cetera. But it is good to be back from the third circle of hell, as I was joking before we started recording, because we folks, if none of you are Southern Californians, you will be unacquainted unless you've seen maybe pictures of San Francisco this morning, looking like the surface of Mars. We're down in Southern California, so there's a fire to our north, a little bit to the northwest, a fire a little bit to our southwest. And so it's sort of perpetual twilight here in Claremont, orange like the sunset at 11 a.m., among other times. So we're doing our best. I'm joined, as always, well, not almost always, by Spencer Clavin, assistant editor of the Claremont Review Books and the American Mind, and James Pullis, executive editor of the American Mind. David Barr is indisposed, and Matthew Peterson is gallivanting somewhere in Red America with his family, somewhere between the border of Pennsylvania and New York, or between. Yeah, no man's land in between the borders. Matt should be back next week. Well, we wanted to open today with a discussion of, what's been on our mind for the last 100 days. Oh, riots. That's right. Riots, and more riots. And really, more than anything, the media's coverage of those riots. So there's this interesting little summary report from one of the longtime intelligent and interesting media critics out there, Steve Saylor, who writes about how there's this new report out from a left-wing group studying this in an attempt to talk about how most of the riots are peaceful. And this, of course, is how it was reported at CNN and elsewhere. And their conclusion was, after studying this countrywide, that about 93% of racial justice protests in the U.S. since the death of George Floyd have been peaceful and non-destructive. About 7,750 of those protests were linked to Black Lives Matter. Peaceful racial justice protests took place in more than 2,440 locations across all 50 states. Violent demonstrations occurred in fewer than 220 locations, according to the report. That's sort of the top line takeaway. And Saylor's point is, in other words, there have been riots in almost 220 different cities. Now, to you and me, riots in approximately 218 places might sound like a lot, especially since there were multiple riots in many of these locations. So we wanted to just talk about the weird extent to which our mainstream media institutions seem to be purposefully gaslighting the rest of the country on this issue. It's been a theme on this podcast in recent weeks. You all talked about, you know, you just look at Twitch a week ago and see all these feeds, live, amazing thing in modern digital media, live feeds of nightly riots, whether it be in Wisconsin or Oregon or elsewhere. And yet our media, for longstanding, deepening partisan reasons, for the most part, is uninterested in reporting it because they worry. And it looks like over the last month, they have good reason to worry that it's beginning to chip away at what was thought to be an unassailable lead by the National Democrats, especially the presidential candidate, Mr. Biden.
Well, I want to know if 7% is an acceptable rate of failure for the riots. What does that mean about coronavirus lockdowns? That if coronavirus is, does that mean that we can just remove the lockdown until coronavirus kills 7% of the population? No, we all kind of think of dystopia as the thing where they just shove all the true news down the memory hole and erase what's really going on and just give you their imagined version of it. But as Orwell knew very well, and as indeed was illustrated on an episode of Star Trek Next Generation at one point, the true dystopia is when they force you to look at the thing that's going on and then tell you that something else is going on. That's true mind control is when Twitch is available, when you can look out your window, as I have often done in Los Angeles, and see people tearing storefronts apart, burning things, burning cop cars, rioting, and be told that it is not going on, and be asked to accept that it's not happening. That's why the memory hole isn't just about erasing things. It's about things that you remember happening being magicked away into nothing. I believe that the kind of the demoralization here is the point. I've felt for some time that being asked to wear a mask in situations that make no sense, being asked to pretend like it's okay that your city is being burnt down, that's the whole idea, is just to push their control over the narrative so far that it extends even into areas where your own perceptual data, where your own physical experience of the world contradicts what they're saying, and you have to accept what they are saying. It's quite remarkable.
It's so easy to play with numbers. That's why people do it all the time and substitute it for actual political thinking.
Yeah.
Over 200 cities targeted, victimized by violent riots. In some cities, you can only riot once, whether because you actually have a functioning police force or sheriff's department that restores order, or because you burn the city and you can't burn the same block of rubble twice. At the same time, how many days, nights in a row has there been violent rioting in Portland? One city. Reduced to a state of basically unending, unceasing insurrection with the complicity of elected officials flatly refusing to put down the violence. Those are numbers too. And those are stats that we can bandy about as well. And it gets to a point where the media organs that are attempting to be the final authorities on which stats matter and which stats don't, just create the same thing that the total silence on the death of Jeffrey Epstein, to return to one of our favorite topics, created, which is just a scrim of data that cannot be parsed by an ordinary citizen and does not provide a foundation for making prudential political judgments. And so what you have to go with is, your lying eyes, as mm-hmm. they say. And that's why people are tuning in to the live feeds. And that's why these clips are making the rounds, is because the statistics, people have been ripping on statistics for a long time, and statistics have gotten their ration of abuse, deservedly so. But it's more than just chopping numbers around, which is the same thing that we see with polls. People are experiencing data fatigue, and they're experiencing it to a degree that they, don't particularly want to tell pollsters how they might vote. And they don't, they're not going to avail themselves of statistical information that is either presented to them as fact or is a product into which they've been turned by social scientists. We can moan, as some do on the internet, about how this betokens a rise of misinformation. But really, the misinformation has been with us always, in the form of authoritative elite content pills, which people swallowed, whether out of habit or because they felt compelled to, and all that's starting to go away.
Yeah, James, I think I sort of raised this point months and months ago, but it's worth raising again. You like to talk a lot about and write about, and I think it was prescient when you were doing it a couple years ago, and it's now sort of fully blossoming, which is to say our elites are panicking about their lost hold on the public imagination, which they used to be able to control through television as the main medium. But as you've pointed out, the rise of digital media has sort of sapped their ability to control that narrative, and so they're panicking. The political analog, I mean, it's all politics, but the political analog, I was talking to our friend and senior fellow and sage scholar John Marini this morning, and one of his repeated themes about the last 40 years in American politics, which has its roots in the last 100 years of American politics, is you have the rise of expertise and the death of real politics. So you have we see it with COVID. We see it with the riots and everything else. The only really acceptable form of knowledge upon which to base politics is this expert knowledge, this social scientific knowledge, which is controlled by, you know, a pretty insular and self-confident and even arrogant group of elites, whether it be whether it's the epidemiologists like Fauci or the various claims to, as Spencer said and James amplified, to not believe your lying eyes and instead to believe the latest statistic. Digital sort of blowing it all up in a way, and the riots are just another example. And it's interesting that the sort of confluence of the riots and COVID and the flying around of official knowledge that does all manner of things like restrict you to your house and keep you out of church, but allow you to go on the streets, but only if you're the right kind of protester. You know, this, it has led to what I hope will be a kind of denouement of this kind of political expert knowledge and its ability to rule our lives. We're seeing the disintermediation of all this kind of authority. And it provides a great opportunity, although it's quite disorienting to our national political life together.
You know, I was revisiting this morning a piece which I will commend to people because James was probably too modest to commend it himself. A while back, James wrote on American Mind a piece called OK Pollster, which details with great prescience some of the things that we are now seeing kind of in full flower. And the reason I was thinking about that piece today is because Nate Silver, who is the kind of pollster par excellence, the poll cruncher extraordinaire, who ever since he made his name kind of calling sports games, he's become our great guru of this religion of kind of expertise and data crunching. Silver tweeted today, "I've pointed out this contradiction before, but there's a type of person who believes that outward, highly public signs of Trump enthusiasm, yard signs, rally attendance, etc., are more reliable than polls, but that Trump voters are too shy to tell the truth to pollsters." Now, this is a laughably incoherent tweet. Basically, what he's saying is here are these two reasons why people don't trust my data expertise. Mm-hmm. One is they think people are lying to the polls, and another is that they think that they see with their eyes evidence that contradicts the polls. And how can both of those things be true? Ha ha, got you there. You know, now surely you must listen to my data over your lying eyes. But of course, both of the things could entirely be true because mm-hmm. your anecdotal data in your neighborhood could be obviously pointing toward Trump, but there might be many other people in other neighborhoods who are lying to pollsters. It's laughably facile reasoning from Silver. But what it illustrates, I think, is that all of this expertise mongering that you're talking about is based on this idea that there exists a box called specialized knowledge or specialism, right? The kind of stuff that you have to study for years to learn. Now I have a PhD in statistics. I can kind of understand the stuff that you, average person, are unable to understand. And increasingly, what we're seeing is that actually inside that box labeled specialism was just a bunch of elite presuppositions and presumptions about the world that have to do with how terrible you, deplorable, are, and that are shaping the way that these studies are even getting constructed. Because, of course, any baseline philosopher of math knows that the presuppositions from which you begin shape the kinds of questions you ask, shape the kinds of results that you end up with. And so people are starting to cry foul on this because at last it is just too obviously bankrupt, I think, to ignore.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well,
Sorry.
Go ahead. No, you, James.
All right. Well, you know, I'm not too modest to stop riding my hobby horses on the podcast. So, you know, what we've seen under this kind of pressure, and I would argue that this began, you know, back roughly with the assassination of JFK, is a collapse of knowledge work and its replacement with fantasy work. And as Spencer suggested, you know, you scratch a knowledge worker, and what you find under there is someone who really is saying, I correctly understand ethics because I know how to dream the correct utopia. And my job is to put that utopia into your head and make you identify with it and make you pursue it. This is what public relations is. This is what the ad industry is. This is what Hollywood is. This is increasingly what academia is, and science as well. And so, of course, we see the march of critical race theory through all of these institutions. And we'll talk about some of these things more in a bit, but just by way of foreshadowing, it's an excuse for sucking at like actual work. You look at what happened to the Oscars, you look at what happened to the Academy. It is a grand trump card to play when you say, well, but wait a minute, you know, like the economic pie hasn't grown for ordinary Americans, or, you know, I was promised jetpacks, or, you know, why does it look like Mars when I look out my window in what's ostensibly the most forward-looking city in the world, San Francisco? You know, why are we experiencing stagnation and decline and decadence and IQs are dropping and, you know, this endless parade of backward indicators or stagnant indicators? You know, why can't we win wars anymore? And the answer is, well, we got the utopia right in our heads. And so we are pure and you can't criticize us. In fact, you have to bow to us because our job is not to provide you with knowledge. It's not to provide you with the facts. It's not to provide you with a grasp on reality that will allow you to exercise agency in your life in concert with your neighbors and fellow citizens. It is, in fact, just to give you the right fantasy. And if you don't like it, we're going to force you to like it and say so.
Yeah.
One kind of, I mean, this is perhaps really just a gloss, James, on what you've just said, but from a kind of epistemological standpoint, right, the thing that was being proposed to us, and it's, in many ways, it's an Enlightenment or a scientific revolution presupposition that you can separate, like, raw data from theory, that your idea about like how to organize information is a totally separate and distinct thing from your ability to just gather the so-called objective facts, the kind of like this many people do X at Y time. And for a long, long time, the experts, the Faucis and the Nate Silvers of the world, told us that what they were going to do is they were going to go out there and they were going to scrabble up all the data so that we could apply our theory, so that we as sort of free citizens of a liberal society could process that data however we want according to our own ideas about what the right way of life is, about what the good is, and so forth. And James, what you are eloquently elucidating is that in fact what they were doing is just the reverse, or at least what the facts that they were providing us were heavily inflected with a very specific set of values and a very specific theory, which is quite antithetical to the way of life that most Americans for most of the history of the country, and indeed most Westerners for most of the history of the West, have believed was true and good and beautiful and right. And that's what's becoming so apparent at the moment. And that's why, for example, our elites would more readily do business with China than with the state, the American state of Georgia, because Georgia's values are less in line with the CEOs of Disney, who won't film in the state of Georgia, but will film in Xinjiang, where the Chinese are holding Uyghur Muslims in concentration camps. Right? That is why we've reached this point, is because for a long time there have been smuggled into our public discourse a set of very specific ideas about the good that are the opposite of the American ideas about the good.
Yeah, we rejected the ancient wisdom of the West, which is that, you know, justice is hard. Perfect justice on this, you know, going pre-Christian, but sort of getting carried through the Christian tradition as well. Justice on this earth is impossible. Perfect justice, anyway. Political justice is very difficult. People are self-interested, hence limited government, et cetera, et cetera. And the progressive dream was always, no, we have this new science that will allow us to implement perfect justice. And the first generation at the turn of the, you know, starting after the Civil War and sort of coming in full flowering in it with Woodrow Wilson, a little break, and then FDR, Great Society, et cetera, that, you know, if only we could get government enough power and get enough experts in, the will to justice could be carried out, and its implementation would be a technical problem. But I think there were a bunch of sincere progressives, and I think there still are sincere, you know, do-gooder progressives. But I think there's a big portion of the kind of postmodern movement, whether it be critical race theory or anything else, that has decided they're in James's camp. You know, this is all a matter of will and manipulation, and so we have to gather for you the right thoughts and the right imagination and go about implementing, well, it's value-free because nothing has value. There's no such thing as truth, but we kind of like this thing together and we're going to implement it, and damn you if you don't embrace it.
This is a point that's drawn out, I think, quite powerfully and even beautifully in a book called American Awakening that's not out yet, but it will be soon, by Josh Mitchell. Full disclosure, my former professor at Georgetown. And it really makes the proper political theory case for small L liberalism, you know, the liberalism of self-governance and the liberalism of Locke and the liberalism of, you know, Tocqueville and others, who, as Mitchell explains, you know, understood that that questions of justice are hard questions. They're hard questions to answer. And in order to answer them well, not only do you need to understand like what it is to be a human being and what our human facilities and capabilities and flaws are, but you also need to be able to get into the details, the petty details of everyday life, where individuals, at least until the lockdowns imprisoned us in the internet, encounter one another face to face in real life. And if people are unable or unwilling to encounter themselves that way, then they cannot do the work of self-governance, of building a shared world together. And the temptation among human beings is to always look for shortcuts. And the temptation among any kind of elite is to find a way to persuade ordinary people that they have the shortcuts. They've got it all figured out, whether it's by perfecting the science of politics or by perfecting science or technology on such a level that politics of any kind no longer becomes necessary, to spinning the right kinds of utopian fantasies or Gnostic dreams, so that, you know, you can neglect or reject your physical body and focus on, you know, all just living on some sort of elevated plane of the spirit, as Hegel says, the spirit that hovers over the world. That is not our lot in life. And if we want to remain human, and we should want to remain human, even if we are supplemented in some ways, we don't want our dreams to supplant the pursuit of justice among human beings in the real world. We don't want technology or science to supplant human agency and the work that we always must do ourselves and families and communities and neighborhoods to create and maintain and nourish just ways of living.
Amen, Brother James. Yeah, the hard work of practical judgment here and now, bringing about the most good and doing the least harm. That's we got to get back to that somehow, rather than this endless shell game of quote unquote expertise ruling us without our consent. To the basement people, to the basement, many surprises await you. In the basement people, in the basement. You hit the last time, you know we're well, speaking of Imagineers, the Oscars and expertise. So the Oscars, which has been lamenting for years now, their lack of sufficient diversity in their awards, has now decided to mandate it. You know, the Oscars is a weird thing. It is kind of a decentralized thing in a way. The Academy is made up of members of at various, points of production, direction, superintendents of general movie making throughout the industry, and they all get to vote. So it is a remarkably uncontrollable operation. And it's secret balloting, too, God forbid. So you can't tell who's transgressing the latest diktats of justice. So the Oscars, the Academy has decided to mandate a certain amount of on-set diversity in performances and staff, et cetera, including, of course, inspections to make sure that you, comrade, are conducting yourself in a proper manner while you're filming Mulan with, you know, guard towers in the distance from the Uyghur camps. There was about there just to pick up on a theme of Spencer's from the last one. There was a good Babylon Bee tweet today that was like, editing error occurs in Mulan, and they have a scene where she's like running across a roof, and they forgot to scrub out the camp towers in the distance for the concentration camps. So, yeah, Oscar's so woke. I mean, in a way, it's nothing new. It's just the latest evolution. I suppose it was inevitable, and I'm surprised it took them this long to get there. But and it has very weird timing too. I mean, at a point at which people are because of COVID, they're making fewer movies than they ever had, and people are watching fewer movies, at least, you know, screen movies. Tenet just opened to a very tepid $20 million weekend, which is Christopher Nolan's latest, which was, you know, over $200 million to make. He's maybe lucky. I haven't seen the film, but it fiercely divides people's opinion about its complicated virtue or its you know, sort of obscure vices in terms of storytelling. But he can chalk it up to theaters being closed in New York and Los Angeles and everything else. But anyway, what do you all think of what does this mean for the future of movie making? I mean, at a time when we're inundated by Netflix streaming stuff of all varying manners of quality, I mean, are the Oscars sort of planting a woke flag at precisely the time when no one will care?
It's funny. I like the idea of Tenet's sort of coronavirus failures being a mercy killing. Like it was just kind of taken out secretly in the back and shot.
I don't generally like the man, but John Podhoretz had a very negative review of it where he made his compelling case for being kind of purposefully obscure. But we have a lot of friends who thought it was sort of genius. So I reserve judgment for now.
This though, I mean, there is something I think really profound in your, I believe, spontaneous citation of a Babylon Bee article about a Walt Disney streaming release on Netflix. Mm-hmm. Because Disney is, if anything, they invented the term Imagineer, right? They are mm-hmm. the representatives of the televisual modality of putting your content out into the world in this pre-imagined kind of fantasia that you then buy into as a movie viewer and get fed a series of values, get fed a series of ideas about what could be, what should be, and so forth. When I saw that Oscars thing, sort of went off into a series of reflections about art and patronage, because like on the one hand, my immediate reaction was, oh, right. So, I mean, film has been dead for these many years. I can't think of the last time I saw a movie that genuinely felt like living art, that felt like something that really had touched me in the way that, you know, the novels of the 19th century could do and so forth. And art seems to me to have gone a million other places, to have gone to video games, to have gone to websites like the Babylon Bee, which is why I think it's interesting, like the kind of the most incisive cultural commentary about that Mulan moment is from this kind of wacky satire site, which is doing art. I mean, is creating weird visual reconstructions of things, is making snide side of the mouth satirical comments in the tradition of Juvenal and the great satirists of old. You know, I mean, and I'm actually quite serious about that. I mean, it sounds like a joke, but I'm quite serious about it, that like all of the great institutions of artistic credentialism in America have become so visibly corrupt. And when that happens, usually, I think, in history, like art goes elsewhere. Creativity goes elsewhere. Like true, vital, important art goes elsewhere. All of that having been said, on the other hand, you know, patronage is famously complex in its relationship to artistic creation. And there would be no Petrarch if there were not an Italian Renaissance tradition of kind of wealthy patrons allowing him to kind of wander about Avignon and other places in continental Europe. You know, and so the Oscars will have an effect on movies by doing this. They'll make people want to win Oscars. They'll make people – but it seems to me that the stage of artistic development that we're in I hope, is not the stage where patrons are kind of having an effect on the real art. I think we're at the stage where, like, the real art hasn't yet been recognized, and so it sounds funny and you blush to even talk about the Babylon Bee as art. But that's what's going on right now. And in 20, 30, 40, 50 years, we'll all look back at the time when, you know, the Oscars killed art and real art was living in this place that had not yet been seen.
One of the virtues of Hollywood, I suppose, is, at least modern Hollywood, is it there's so much money sloshing around in it that you can... you can make your way to the top and amass a large fortune and become a kind of self-patron. And that's where some of the art still comes out. I mentioned Nolan, reserving judgment on Tenet, but I mean, one of the great movies of recent time, I think. He's always played with time in sort of annoying ways often. His World War II, you know, what was that movie called? Help me.
Oh, Dunkirk.
Thank you, Dunkirk. Yes. Saved by the producer.
There you go.
Dunkirk was interesting. Mel Gibson, another one who... whether it's Hacksaw Ridge of course, Passion of the Christ long ago made him ultra mega wealthy. But he's the type who've gotten kind of big enough that they can do whatever they want. And it's not high art, but I think of even like, did Michael Bay do the one, the 13 Hours?
Yes.
Was it Bay? Is that a blasphemy? Anyway, which was, it told a sort of counter narrative of what happened in Benghazi. At the embassy and the CIA annex and all that, where that story could, because it was sort of reflected bad on the Obama State Department and Hillary Clinton, would have really never been made but for someone who has enough money and enough success to just say, I'm going to do it anyway.
I think all these examples are striking in that they are all about men. This is Los Angeles, living here or around here. It's this conversation is in the air, and a lot of people are grappling with what the future of cinema holds, and you know, even off the big screen onto the small screen, what the future of storytelling holds and the visual representation of narrative stories. I was just at a small and compliant gathering of individuals who were discussing this theme. And, one of the theories that was aired as a way of grappling with this is that it is characteristic of Western culture that the overwhelming share of stories in any medium are stories about the feats of men, of this grown men coming of age, the things that men do drive plots. And that's the overwhelming share of our stories. As a writer and a person with a lot of books in his home, who does watch the television and watches films from time to time, fiction and nonfiction, no one has to convince me that stories about women and stories about young women and stories driven by female characters are important and interesting and civilized and valuable and good. I'm not going to be arguing that point.
We're all Jane Austen fans.
I hope.
Oh,
yeah. I mean, it
seems and George Eliot, perhaps even.
Yeah. There are plenty of examples.
Right.
But all those examples are never going to come close to overwhelming the number of examples of stories that concern the drama of the man and the deeds of the man. And this is all a very roundabout way of saying, if you go back to the last time when Hollywood was really in clover and Hollywood was the source of great glamour and fascination and power and sophistication and intrigue and money, all of the fresh blood that came in and made the new Hollywood in the 60s and the 70s. Sure, there were the starlets and there were the charismatic actresses, as there always are, but it was overwhelmingly male. It was young men who wanted to tell raw stories about hard men and the inner workings of their minds and the outer workings of their guns and their words. And that injection of, in some ways a debased or overclocked masculinity, but a very distinct and instantly recognizable masculinity nonetheless, is what brought Hollywood into the modern era and what turned it into the phenomenon that it was globally, 60s, 70s, 80s, into the 90s. And that energy has all but dissipated. Christopher Nolan is keeping the flag flying for the deeds of men as a subject of cinema. But even he has to sort of like distort it or view it through this kind of funky time warp field, distortion field that he uses. There is a reluctance to present these kind of unvarnished and, you know, from a creative standpoint, vulnerably open stories about ordinary men in extraordinary circumstances. Clint Eastwood will do a thing here and there. Mm-hmm. Hell or High Water.
Yep.
Is one of those films. But they're kind of, you know, they're not characterizing cinema today. And I think that the collapse of the drama of the man in Hollywood and across art in America has led to, you know, lackluster results that it understandably makes some people uncomfortable to talk about or even think about for too long. But what comes in its wake, you know, is this very sterile and overwrought and arcane. It's almost as if the Oscars have their own human resources department now.
Yeah.
And, you know, speaking as someone who is willing to grant artists in some cases wildly more latitude in what they say and think than I think ordinary people should have culturally, artists have a special pass to be extreme and unusual and strange and even threatening. Speaking as someone who believes all that, you can't turn artistry into a popular enterprise in which everyone is an artist and then impose this sort of bureaucratic superstructure on the popular production of art. The results just suck. And that's why critical race theory is there to race in and say, oh, no, this, you know, the old standards about quality art are gone. You know, you don't have to worry about whether this is actually great art or whether even it's very good, because it checks the right utopian boxes.
You're making me think, James, about Tarantino and Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, which when I said earlier, I can't think of the last time I really saw a movie that made me just bleed, you know, that's kind of the movie that maybe is comes the closest. And that movie is all about, it's not just about men and their deeds. It's about the very dynamic that you're describing on some level, because it describes a Hollywood culture in which manhood has either been desiccated or domesticated, that there's all the kind of great men of the past are either phonies or they've been kind of anesthetized into this weird kind of like hippie commune. The Brad Pitt character.
Robert Redford.
Yeah, he looks like Robert Redford, but it's the Brad Pitt character who's basically the only man left living. You know, he basically wanders through this wasteland, and what's wonderful about him is that he doesn't get any of the respect that the Leo DiCaprio character gets, who is the sort of sham version of him, but he secretly is that person. And I toy all the time with what it means for an art form to be dead, because, I mean, I believe the novel is quite dead, and yet I believe there are many great novelists, not many, but some noteworthy novelists writing.
Secret of the past, there were never very many great novels.
Right. Fair enough. I mean, there is a telescoping effect to time.
Yeah, sure.
But even so, there was a time at least when the latest novel was something you would wait on the docks for. I mean, what was it, Little Dorrit, that people waited on the docks for Dickens to find out whether she lived or died? You know, there was a time when there was that kind of urgency to the art form of the novel as it was at that point serialized. That is completely lacking for me, even from the great novels of the current era. So Donna Tartt is a good example of somebody whose novels I love and derive much joy from, but whose novel I do not wait for to find out more about.
Who? Just
Donna Tartt. The Secret History, The Little Friend, and The Goldfinch are the kind of the
three big ones. Right.
And The Secret History is obviously kind of like near and dear to me because it's about classics, about studying the classics at an elite university and how that all go terribly wrong.
Catnip.
Right. But I believe she is a great novel. I mean, Michelle Wheelebeck, I've talked about on this podcast before, I believe is a great novelist. I like think my like full disclosure, I think my dad's a really good novelist, you know. and I but I do not sit at the door waiting for the next novel the way that I kind of do, like check refresh the Babylon Bee page. And I sort of think that like and I sort of think that there is something about the context in which a certain work of art occurs that makes this Oscar thing the most the truly killing blow to film, which is that even if you make Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, what you're basically saying is the vitality of what I'm portraying to you has only one position in modern society, and that is the lone renegade against the entire world. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a, the reason that that's a compelling film is because that's basically accurate. And what James is saying, that like the 13 Hours is a film that can only take place in the context of rebellion against a prevailing narrative. I note, by the way, that John Krasinski starred in 13 Hours. Yeah. I sort of think he's like a covert, maybe not so covert mm-hmm. conservative, because his the other another great
well,
movie,
The Quiet, Quiet Place.
Right, yeah, it's excellent, really good movie.
Don't dox Krasinski.
Yeah, I'm sure that everybody is going to now cancel him having said that.
But,
yeah, it's the context, I think, that I'm really kind of trying to get at, that even good movies occur in a context where manhood and excellence and the kinds of narrative virtues that James is indicating are not the norm, and that mm-hmm. is killing.
Well, talked.
This does seem right, and I'll try to make it brief for
yes, please.
Of all listeners and recorders of this podcast.
Jake is flashing the 1 minute sign at us.
Yeah. Okay. I'll do it on 2x speed. Donna Tartt, if I recall correctly, classmate speed. Of Brett and Sinelis at Bennington, both go on to be novelists. Brett has a podcast of his own called the Brett and Sinelis Podcast. He just had Walter Kern on, and they discussed this very thing about the death of the novel and, you know, where did it all go, and they talk about famous novelists from even the 1970s who had multiple bestsellers, and now they didn't even get an obit in the New York Times.
Yeah.
Oof, like gone. And one of the points that was made in that podcast is, you know, you used to see people carrying books around with them and reading them on the beach and reading them on the metro or whatever. And now, of course, the book is gone and the phone is in everyone's hand.
Yeah.
And the point that was made was, you know, the book used to be your phone, your cell phone. Mm. Really. It was how you connected with the outside world. It was how you understood how to read people and interact with them and sort of what language to speak and what cadence to use. And it was your education into your fellow human beings. And it was formative. And so, you know, I do find myself asking, you know, what is the kind of masculinity that it issues forth from a digital medium? We know sort of how masculinity has been treated and propagated through print and through radio and through television and through film. It's still kind of an open question. You know, is the cell phone capable of producing manly men? I don't know.
Well, lest we be accused of being too get off my lawn-ish, I will say that, you know, there's a strong minority, even I dabble in it sometimes, who on their phones are reading books, just in the digital form. And one of the great blessings in this, you know, you've talked about this, James, or the sort of, you know, these machines that can remember everything and can retrieve anything. You know, there is a certain silver lining in that we can have all the great literature of the world on this phone in front of us and read it at any point. Unfortunately, what we're usually doing is, you know, looking at Instagram, or tweeting, or not to hate on tweeting, but you know, it's a mixed bag. No, while we're plugging movies and manliness, and I talked about Mel Gibson earlier, it did not come immediately to mind, but I will plug and say it's worth rewatching Apocalypto, which is the fastest 3-hour movie you'll ever watch in your life. It's really an extraordinary feat of, among other things, direction and plot moving, and a very interesting movie.
Also The Patriot. Wow, that movie holds up.
Really?
It's corny as hell, but it's rugged. Yes.
It's good. It's like Braveheart America, right?
It makes me – it is not only childless men that go to war is the line that really sticks out from me. Yes, it's magnificent. Christian Bale, isn't it? No, not Christian Bale. The other kind of broody blonde who died. Heath Ledger is in it magnificently as a young man. Yes. Pay my respects to grace and virtue. Send my condolences to good. Give my regards to soul and romance. They always did the best they could. And so long to devotion. You
nothing like a final segment based on one of our favorite subjects, the endless, interminable identity politics flooding every part of our life. Although we're going to, we'll cleanse that with a little bit of uplifting Halloween talk. That's sardonic, and we'll see why later. Our friend Chris Rufo, who's a former Lincoln fellow, if you are on Twitter and want a good follow and you don't already follow him, he's at Real Chris Rufo, I think. Chris works for the Discovery Institute. He has an affiliation with the Manhattan Institute as well. Has been writing a lot for both organizations, doing a lot of work. He's a documentarian by training and by avocation. But he's made a little cottage industry, and we've mentioned him before on the podcast, out of exposing this insane infiltration of our institutions, both local and national and federal, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, of critical race theory. This kind of what was for a long time a pretty academic. It's always been pernicious, but it had a smaller footprint for a long time. But it, you know, basically teaches that whiteness is sort of evil embodied. It's this white supremacy and whiteness, and the West is the source of the world's miseries. And, you know, if only we can confess our whiteness, understand it, and expunge it, and elevate non-whiteness, then we're going to bring justice, truth in the American way to lands both to states at home and lands abroad. So the latest thing is, so they're not surprisingly to some of our friends in the defense industry or in the wider defense policy community who are right wing and who've seen this for a long time, whether it's in the military at the brass or elsewhere, is the invasion of critical race theory to our academies, military academies. So there was reported the fact of this at West Point, where, among other things, they're taught an introduction to critical race theory and an introduction to critical queer theory, among other things. And Chris's tweet about it was that this really is not improving our warfighting capability or our leadership skills in our military brass. And it comes partly due to Chris's shining a light on all this. It all started with him getting tipped off in his locality. I think it started with Seattle sort of training their local folks, local government officials, that they had to, you know, reject their whiteness and have struggle sessions about their inherent skin color-based evil and all the rest. And then he started getting tips from people across the federal government, across different state institutions in education. And so, you know, I mean, the man's probably going to end up making a living exposing all this stuff because it's everywhere. Yep. And, you know, it caught the eye of the president and some in his administration. So Trump's on the warpath against critical race theory, and it's teaching across the federal government. Chris Rufo informs us that Betsy DeVos and the Department of Education are going to take a look at this to the extent they can and try to do something about it in our nation's schools. But it's just the latest front in the radical left's attempt to poison Americans against their country and against each other. And so we shouldn't be surprised that it's infiltrated even our military academies.
Well, Chris is
and shield themselves from all criticism.
Right.
We don't need an army that can win wars.
It's partly a racket.
We don't need an intelligence community that can gather intelligence. We don't need teachers who can teach. We don't need anything. And we can't fire these people because, well, they got the theory right. I mean, it's all so fatuous. Like, as if intelligence operations are any stranger to, like, queer lifestyles. I mean, like, they are well aware of, like, what human nature is and what kind of people tend to be willing to turn their lives over to being spies and double agents and assets. And, you know, there is a consistent interaction with the full, you know, the truly the full rainbow of human experience and inclination. If you have any business working in intelligence, you are familiar with these things. And so it's, you know, but now it's not good enough to be queer or straight or bi or anything. You have to be possessed by the theory now as well. And of course, the theory is in fact, contrary to what is oftentimes represented. The theory does not emanate spontaneously from your identity. No, you can have the identity, but you still need to be instructed in the theory. You still need to be officially ushered into, you know, the secrets of the temple, which I find to be, you know, not just dismaying on the level of, you know, the sort of state within a state quality of all this, but genuinely offensive to, you know, to people who whose privileged identities are being co-opted out from under them, and then used in this kind of shell game where, you know, that you get them in the door by saying you're privileged and you're special, and we're going to, you know, at last treat you the way you deserve to be treated. And then the minute they get in the door and sit down, they're lectured to the same way as anyone else and told that if they don't parrot back the correct theory, then they haven't really earned their identity.
There is something very powerful to what you're saying, James, I think. I mean, Chris works, in some cases at least, in concert with James Lindsay, who has written at The American Mind and is a friend of Claremont's as well as of many other esteemed institutions. And James posted, other James Lindsay posted, I think it was from 2018, kind of internal footage from one of these struggle sessions in which an African-American woman stood up in front of a group of mostly white people and proclaimed without in full seriousness that all white people are racist. White people are born and bred to be demons. And if you follow Chris Ruffo or James Lindsay on Twitter, you can easily find this footage. Mm-hmm. It's not a joke. They're not kidding around. And the mechanism whereby dissenting people of the relevant identity groups are excluded. So people, gay conservatives or black conservatives or conservatives of any who qualify for any of this ostensible protection under intersectional identity politics, the way that those people are excluded is by redefining the identity in terms of the politics. And this is, of course, an old Marxist technique. You can learn about it, actually, if you read our recent feature on this, the Marxist racialism of Antifa and BLM. On AmericanMind.org, it's kind of laid out quite precisely that this is an old tactic that you basically usher people in on the basis of their ethnicity or their sexuality or their gender or what have you, and then you redefine their gender in terms of your politics so that in order to maintain the special status that is granted them by virtue of their demographic, they need to get in line with your politics. And this was, I think, most sort of precisely articulated by The Advocate, which was at one time kind of a great magazine. Well, great is the wrong word, but at one time it was a leading magazine of the, as it were, gay community, which proclaimed that Peter Thiel was not gay, that there's a difference between homosexuality and sleeping with men, because Thiel came out in favor of Donald Trump. Yeah. And you can find this article.
False consciousness.
Right, right, exactly. Yeah. And so, and it's more than false. I mean, false consciousness and conscious raising is the idea that, right, you just don't know how oppressed yet you are. But one step beyond that is that if you don't, if you refuse to accept, even after you have been browbeaten and struggle sessioned into a full acceptance of Marxism, if you refuse even then to bend the knee, then you will be stripped of your protected status. And in some way, the kind of realities of your very body and soul will be nullified, will be made as naught in the face of the encroaching Marxist behemoth, which is, of course, the famous way that Marxism basically strips all people of their identity. It's just one more iteration of this. And I think people need to like grasp this. They need to understand that none of this is about black people or about LGBT people or what have you. It's purely about this Marxist dynamic of luring people in on the basis of identity and then stripping them of that identity and making them into cogs in the communist machine.
But it also taps into an ancient human desire for absolution and spiritual purity. So, and that same that same session that you're talking about, of course, she has on her whiteboard all white people are racist, and you can kind of see that, of course, and we've seen it in all these things. The first thing you do is confess your white privilege or whatever, and then at the bottom of her little whiteboard it says, you know, here you can give me money at PayPal.
Pay me for this.
You can pay your indulgence here. Confess your sin, whitey, and you can pay your indulgence here. And you know, you gotta be wiped clean. You can leave this room absolved of at least temporarily until the next installment of the struggle session and the paying. It's really extraordinary. So, grifting is as old as human nature too. So,
right. Well, I mean,
there's a lot of money to be made in this.
An important point to make, right, is that like this is cancer. It's not just like kind of a thing that we can laugh at anymore that goes on in kind of kooky corners of the elite academy. And when, I mean, Trump issued this memo basically calling for the eradication of this form of indoctrination from federally funded training sessions, which...
Well, even narrower than that, right? I mean, it's mostly federal agencies.
Yeah, right? That's right.
Training of federal agencies.
Excuse me. Yeah, it was not anywhere that receives tax dollars. It was, you know, the federal government.
We can only hope.
Right. Training its own people. And that's what I mean. I mean, it's only the very, very tip of the iceberg. I mean, somebody posted on Twitter today a picture of a kindergarten class that has this sign up front that says things like Black Lives Matter, you know, and all these kind of slogans, these now recognizable slogans of the woke left. And yeah, it's only this teeny tiny, it feels like this massive breath of fresh air to us. And it is, because nobody but Trump would ever have done this, to have said, you know, that we're actually going to root this stuff out. And yet it's only the tiniest step in the direction that we need to go. I mean, everybody responded to this, especially, of course, the critical race theorists themselves. People in general kind of responded to this by gaslighting and saying, well, you know, this, the critical race, you misunderstand what's going on here. You have not really paid close attention to the theory, yada, yada, and so forth. I mean, salt the earth, burn the ground, kick this stuff out. And the reason for it is not that it's like unpalatable to conservatives. The reason for it is that it's actually a dehumanizing ideology that will destroy our... And people have been for so long talking about, you know, oh, history teaches this. History teaches that fascist regimes do X, Y, and Z. And this is kind of the famous stock in trade at this point of our mainstream media. But look, like, we here at the American Mind Podcast, for our sins, actually do study history. And do you know what it teaches? Like, it teaches that republics, free republics, do not survive elite class conspiracy of the kind that this represents. So if we have any hope of moving forward, we just have to root this stuff out.
Yeah, the largest multiracial republic in the history of the world is not going to survive the weaponization of identity politics, and its roots sunk deep in all of our institutions. So, and the interesting reaction, of course, very predictable, Spencer, to that note from the Trump administration trying to get it out of federal training is, of course, shocking. The most racist president in history, as I think of Trump, is now trying to, you know, expunge social justice and racial consciousness from precisely at the time when we need it most from all of our most venerable institutions at the federal level.
I mean, the self-fulfillment of that is kind of... it would be delicious if it weren't so sinister, you know, that because, of course, the definition of racism has itself been at this point conditioned out of all meaning, that we kind of have entered into this world where Trump saying so Trump, after the disaster in Charlottesville, says there are good people on both sides of the question whether you should tear down or remove, let's say, Civil War statues that seem to be favoring the Confederacy.
Yeah.
That is immediately parlayed into there are good people on both sides of the white supremacist, anti-white supremacist.
Right.
Yeah. Right. That enters into the dialect of the mainstream media and therefore all people who kind of accept the mainstream media as gospel truth. And now
Biden launched his presidential campaign on that. Yeah.
Indeed. Right. Well, precisely
on
so.
That lie. Yeah.
And Biden is now trafficking in exactly this form of gaslighting, which we talked about at the very beginning of this podcast, that you say something completely unconscionable, like we're going to reimagine the police, we're going to redirect police funds to other purposes, as Biden has nodded in confirmation that he will do this as president, and then come out there with your face hanging out, as I like to say, although at this point you don't have your face hanging out because you wear the mask, the coronavirus mask, as a way of showing that you're kind of part of this Borg. But you come out there and you say, Donald Trump, as Biden said, Donald Trump is the person who's defunding the police because he's...
I don't want to defund the police. Come on, man. It's
Come on,
Donald
man.
Trump.
Yeah, exactly.
Donald
right. Trump. You know the thing. It's Trump. That's the kind of memory holding we're talking about. It's they stand out there and they tell you, we're going to remove your protection. We're going to burn your cities down. We're going to destroy you unless you put us in power. But it's Trump who's your enemy.
Yeah.
And meanwhile, time is going by. Not only is it being represented to us that wokeness is the single most important thing to concentrate all of our energy on as a society, that if we do this, all else will be fixed, that, oh, what, we're experiencing the greatest transformation in communications media to happen in, you know, 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 years. Well, if we get the wokeness right, then we will be able to make that transition safely. Right? And this logic is applied to everything. It's applied to everything. In addition to that claim, we're also getting the claim that, no, it's not even enough for all of society to put this first in a monomaniacal way. It's not even enough for all of society's elites in and out of government to have that monomaniacal focus. But in fact, every single solitary last one of us from age 2 to age 92 must internalize this as our operating system, the thing which will, through which we must filter all things, including our most intimate relations or our most private thoughts. And meanwhile, time's going by. And what do we have to show for it, right? A litany of failures, not just in policy and in government, but obviously in cultural, cultural life, in economics, in religious life. You can see the toll that it is taking, not just the direct toll, the damage that an obsession with wokeness is creating in our lives, but the knock-on damage, the indirect damage caused by all of the things that we're neglecting as a result.
Yeah, it's also, I mentioned earlier, I was talking to John Marini this morning, and his point was a good one, and we all sort of know it in our bones, of course, but it's all this obsession with woke social justice and critical race theory and everything else as the most pressing issue of our time when, you know, I mean, I'll say it publicly here on the podcast, racism is probably to make the top 20 problem in America. And the more we say that, the healthier our politics will become. But his point was, no, look, I mean, he said we live in absurd times. I mean, our local and state governments can't do normal forest maintenance to prevent one of the worst fire seasons in California's history. The roads suck. They can't maintain your roads. You know, they can't get homeless off the streets in Los Angeles and San Francisco. California's on our mind because we live here, but they're so rankly incompetent. I was looking up earlier. I forgot what prompted it, but you guys know the Transcontinental Railroad, which connected Iowa to California, was built in 5.5 years after the Civil War. I mean, look,
I didn't, but I'm depressed.
Maybe if it took 2 years longer, there would have been less people that died doing it. But the Golden Gate Bridge was, you know, and the Brooklyn Bridge were both built in around a year. It's crazy. We can't really do anything anymore. We can't build anything anymore. So I think there's part of that too. It's this shiny object is that, you know, if the most pressing issue is the lack of complete population parity in every walk of life, depending on race or sexual orientation, everything else, it's a huge tool of distraction for a corrupt and incompetent elite to wield and to deflect blame. I did want to end on a local note. So this is, it's fitting that I'm back in the chair and we've gone through our greatest hits, which is racialized identity politics. And we've mentioned it offhandedly, coronavirus freakout, but we're going to do it in a local way. So LA County has canceled Halloween. Mm. I actually haven't read the details of this, but I'm interested in what manner this is going to be enforced or promulgated. I've just seen the headline. I'm sure they have details about whatever, and local police departments will act like thugs. And any of us who've been seeing some of the reporting from Australia or New Zealand about their increasingly draconian lockdowns, you know, this is sort of a taste. We're getting a taste of it here. But in my neighborhood, in Claremont, so we're blessed to live right in the middle of what's called the Claremont Village and its surrounding neighborhoods. And we usually get 1,200 trick-or-treaters in any given year. We hand out 25 pounds of candy. That's how much we ran out of pound. So 2 years ago, we had 15 pounds. That was gone in an hour. We're like, so this last year, we bought 25 pounds and we ran out in 3 hours. We barely made it to the end of the full Halloween rush. At the end, we were just turning away the 13-year-olds who were on, like, you know, lap number 3. So we didn't feel too bad. But yeah, Halloween is canceled in LA County, we're told. So no door-to-door trick-or-treating. Somebody, I think it was one of the COVID skeptics on Twitter who are worth following, Alex Berenson, I think, said, you know, oh yeah, look, another way in which COVID is damaging the mental health of your children, Halloween is canceled. The idea that somehow it's a great public health threat for a bunch of kids to be walking around neighborhoods and getting candy from from doors is just kind of crazy.
Wearing masks, right? Yeah. I mean, all be wearing masks.
Right.
No, I mean.
An acceptable mask, too. We've been told any mask is okay, right?
Yeah. Well, it was recently told to us that the kind of neck mask.
Oh, the neck gaiter, yeah.
The neck gaiter is unacceptable, which is probably because conservatives were using them to print. Like, in any case, I don't know what kind of enforcement this ruling will be subject to, but I am going to say here in front of all of our listeners and my employers that I intend to find out. I will be trick-or-treating. I don't know if anybody wants to join me, but I would love to know kind of what they're going to do to stop like a grown man indeed a parent with their child from trick-or-treating. Yeah. I'd love to know.
This is the real menace of this kind of overcorrection. And I think that I'm saying this in my capacity as a scientist of politics, as any kind of partisan, is you begin to promulgate rules that are not enforceable in reality, that were they to be enforced would completely outstrip even the best of intentions of even the most unreasonable rule.
Yeah.
If they did enforce these laws, it would involve what? Misdemeanor charges? For 18-year-olds trick-or-treating?
Under what law, right?
Would it involve child services having to be contacted because parents were sending their children out in violation of whatever rule this is? It's untenable. Yeah. And when you pile up enough of these sorts of rules and orders, people start looking at each other in a funny way, and a little thought bubble is exchanged between people, and they start going, are you going to obey this? And then I go, absolutely not. Are you going to do it? No way. See you on Halloween. See you on Halloween.
Right.
That kind of sentiment, that kind of like social telepathy can spread faster than a virus. And it will be interesting to see how this is managed, especially if people who go out on the night before Halloween and commit acts of rampaging violence and destruction and arson are totally free from any kind of punishment.
Mm-hmm. No, I like this, James. So, we should have, it'll just be a Halloween racial justice protest with candy party favors. So that's how you get around it. Well, I, for one, will be on my porch with candy. I don't know. If I get any trick-or-treaters, I'm not going to shoo them away like some insane Karen. And I won't be wearing a mask either. So we'll see how it goes.
From a point of view of intersectionality, and this speaks to our recent conversation about critical race theory, Halloween is the great gay holiday. And so this is literal homophobia. I just want to point that.
Well, I just, before we end, I wanted to plug something that's worth checking out. Our good friend Michael Anton has a book out. It was released last week called The Stakes, America at the Point of No Return. It's not just an election book. It's deep. It's over 400 pages, and it's a diagnostic sort of regime guide to our current state of affairs, including a wonderful chapter on the Parchment Constitution, the view of the founders, an investigation of California. It opens with that and how California is our future if the blues take over for many, many decades. A discussion of the very present topic, an interesting one and controversial one of kind of regime breakdown and the ascendance, crack up of America and the ascendance of one or other blue or red Caesar. Anyway, I'm teasing too much of it. It sounds histrionic, but it's sober, it's interesting, and it's deep. You can hear about it and you can hear a lot about Mike's tenure at the White House from early 2017. For the better part of a year, a little over a year, till about April of 2018, and many other things on this very excellent podcast, which is normally a podcast but has gone to video, and this one was taped live with Jack Murphy's show. So if you Google Jack Murphy Live, Michael Anton, you'll be able to watch video of it. He did it on Periscope, and it's a long interview, but it's non-canned and very candid, and Mike's personality comes through and all of the interesting facets of the last few years of his life, coupled with his diagnosis of America. You should not miss it. While you're at it, come and read his piece for The American Mind, The Coming Coup? ? Which discusses this weird phenomenon of late of some of our friends on the Never Trump right right in scare quotes and the conventional left and the left discussing the possibility of Donald Trump not wanting to leave office and clinging to power when, as far as we're concerned, the left seems to be telegraphing in various ways. The many ways in which Biden should never relinquish his claim to the presidency, regardless of the election results. So with all that, we'll end for the day. Thank you, everyone, for listening to The Roundtable. If you want to learn more, visit our websites at AmericanMind.org, Claremont.org, and ClaremontReviewBooks.com. Don't forget to rate, review, share, and subscribe on Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your podcasts. And I'll adopt Spencer's habit, which is to shamelessly ask you
please
to leave a 5-star review on iTunes. That would be very much appreciated. Thanks to our production and engineering crew, Jake Gannon and Annalisa Lee. And thank you to you all. Talk to you next week. He's the hairy-handed gent who ran amok in Kent. Lately he's been overheard in Mayfair. You better stay away from him. He'll rip your lungs out, Jim. I'd like to meet his tailor. Ow, werewolves of London.